Thunderdome Boxing Talk, Anthony here. Alright, you know, a couple things I want to talk about here. You know, Slava Szymborski, the guy Andre Ward was negotiating with, you know, this is somebody who, in the light heavyweight division, is a monster. A monster, and can't get the big fight. Can't get the big fight. And why? Why would you think that is? I mean, in my opinion, flat out, people are scared of the dude. You know, the dude is extremely close to Kovalev. And I don't mean friendship-wise. I mean, like, style-wise. you know, huge power. Great chin. You know, tight defense. I mean, he's a Ukrainian. Comes out of there, you know, Olympic program. Dude's skilled as all hell. Extremely sound fundamentals. I mean, what else can you expect from that guy? I mean, you know, everyone that comes out of that, you know, that squad, that Ukrainian squad, is 100%, you know, well-rounded. It's very, very rare you'll see someone who isn't. And Postol didn't come from that Olympic team, so don't say, well, Postol. But no, just the skills that Szymborski has, I mean, he's fast. You know, he's fast. Fast with huge power, a good chin. I mean, so you're going to have to give that just alone gives someone problems. And then you add the sound fundamentals. And then he got the footwork, which is, you know, like Kovalev's. The guy, he can move in and out real fast, side to side real fast. Big, long jab. You know, he's like 6'3.5", a 75-inch reach. Got nice reach, good arms, bang, he can reach that jab out. But the thing is, with those long arms, you would think his infighting might not be that great, but he can infight, boy. And he's real athletic to where he can rip shots and come around your arms and dig back up under you. Real good inside fighter, even with the long arms. So he poses a problem no matter where you're at. And it's, you know, he comes to fight, so you'll get your chances to hit him. You gotta be willing to open up, though. And, if you're scared of his power, you're gonna be not gonna want to open up, you know. What I did, though, is, well, first, I got a list of some light heavyweight names off of BoxTrack I wrote down here, that I'm gonna go over, and Szymborski's in the Ring Magazine top 10. He's WBC number 5. You know, he's legit as they get. You know, he's just, he got to that next level, you know, but now he needs another big fight to get him to a title shot, you know, and unless he's going to just sit around and keep waiting for Adonis, who will never pick him, or Kovalev to pick him eventually, you know. Or Ward, if Ward won, or whatever, then that's tough, I mean, you know, then you're going in as the B-side, well, he's always going to have to be the B-side for the moment, but, you know, I've been speaking to his manager for the last week or so. When the whole Szymborski Ward thing happened, I kind of wanted to reach out to him. So I finally got on the phone with him yesterday, and you know, real good guy, real fair. That's the one thing I'll say I noticed about him. And the same goes for Szymborski. They have the same attitude that Loma displayed after the Roman Martinez fight, where it was, you know. Remember Loma said, you know, I just wish that the pros were like the Olympics. You know, in the Olympics, all the best from the world, we all got together, fought each other, and found out who was really the best, you know, in the world. And he's like, I just wish we could do that in the pros. Remember, Loma said that, and I was like, awesome to hear, right? Because that's what you want a fighter to say. his manager is the exact same way, and clearly, you know, stated Shabransky is the exact same way, to the effect that, you know, they got a fight coming up in August, all right, on LA Fight Club. They're the main event on that. But they're even willing for short notice fight, you know, you got a fight in August. They're willing to fight again in September versus any top guy. So they're straight up, if any top light heavyweight wants to get on the Canelo and Liam Smith undercard, make a call to Shabransky. They'll gladly fight anybody for $150,000. Anyone on the Canelo, it's a pay-per-view fucking undercard. You can be the co-main. Imagine Shabransky and Ward on that. I get that it's September, so maybe they couldn't have done that, but they still could have fought. But, I mean, Shabransky and Joe Smith Jr., see who actually gets the shot at the WBC title, you know? And the WBC needs to enforce that shit. That way, Adonis actually fights the guy. Shabransky versus Alexander Gvozdyk. Anyone, 150 grand. I mean, that's not a hard fight to put together. Plus, who you'd get the other fighter would get a ton of exposure. You know, but do you think it'll happen? I sure hope so. I mean, but I think they're scared of him. No, flat out, they're scared. It's really sad because you see these fighters that just come to fight. It's all they want to do is just prove that they're the best, and then they can't get the chance. You know, it's really crazy. At least he's young. He's 26. He got some time, but you know he's I believe he's 16-0 right now with 13 KOs, and he has 16 professional fights, a ton of amateur experience. You know, international, that's blue chipper. However, he's even had, you know, World Series of Boxing fights. And he had like 10 of them, right around 10, somewhere in there. So he's had a lot of experience, you know. Could he use more professional experience? Yeah, but he's ready to go. You know, he's ready to go. He's, like, sitting at that gate just waiting for it to open. There's only so much his manager can do to try and make fights. No one's taking them. And then no one's calling either to be like, hey, we need, okay, will Shabransky fight so-and-so? And there was that whole, the whole Ward thing, which you can go watch Maxwell Bear's video on that. He talked about the Shawnee Monahan situation. Where Sean Moore Monahan said that HBO was tricked and Ward was only using him as leverage to get brand, and that they always wanted brand, and that they used guys like Shabransky and Monahan to kind of trick HBO into like, well, we tried to fight these guys, no one's accepting, the date's coming up, what are we supposed to do? And you know, there's a Ring Magazine article on it that explains all that with Monahan, and you know I can read it. Hold on. Da 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 da. Well, first things first. Also, I want to give a shout out to the Solaris 72. All right, because he dropped a bunch of links and quotes and everything in the in my comment section, and this is just the Solaris. I'm just gonna read what he wrote right here, because this is just me personally and the Solaris. I think I agree with basically everything he says here, and if I don't, I'll state it, but pretty sure I do. He goes, Ward won't dare go anywhere near Kovalev or a top light heavyweight until he's had three fights and a whole year to settle into the new weight. His own trainer has been saying that they wouldn't face Kovalev until Ward was a real light heavy. And his body was acclimated to that weight since at least December 2014. And his body has been acclimated to that weight for a very long time. He's ready to go. And that's the Solaris's opinion, but he's telling you that, well, dude, that Virgil Hunter has been telling you this for forever, for a year, over a year. Then he gives, links to interviews, and he goes, and lo and behold, just as Virgil Hunter said it was going to go down, that's exactly how it went down. Ward won't be going anywhere near Kovalev until he's had that year or longer for his body to acclimate to 175. So we got three tune-ups against, one, a fat and out-of-shape career 168-pounder who was coming off back-to-back losses and who had been blasted out in just two rounds by Groves and stopped in nine one-sided rounds by a green James DeGale. Number two, Sullivan Barrera, who had never been past eight rounds before and only passed six rounds once, and hadn't beaten anyone other than a faded Carl Marat, who was nothing much even when prime. But at least Barrera was actually a light heavyweight, LOL. Number three, Alexander Brand, who is yet another career 168-pounder. He's 40 years old. Damn, I didn't know he was 40 years old. 40 years old, and who has only ever come in above the super middleweight limit once in his career. In his last fight, when he weighed 168 and three quarters or one quarter? I can't read it. It's three quarters or one quarter. I'm sorry, I got bad vision, man. They always wanted Brand. He was their choice. But then they fed us this bullshit about legit light heavies who posed a threat, like Shabransky pricing themselves out. And then he goes, Shabransky was totally up for facing Ward. He just wanted a fair purse. Shabransky's management, and this is Shabransky's manager in a tweet. He says, I see tweets saying at Shabransky is being unrealistic with the purse he expects for an at Andre Ward fight. Not true. Keep it real, please. Then he goes, at Steve UCN Live, that's at Steve Kim. He goes, whoever is feeding you info is wrong. Because Steve Kim, I guess, had reported that Shabransky was being greedy. But I just showed you, he is completely not greedy. He'll fight anyone for $150,000. So how the anyone? So how's he being greedy? And his manager said, say it. You can go ahead and blast that out there. So anyone wants to fight the guy, they can fight him for $150,000 on a pay-per-view undercard. A Canelo undercard, nonetheless. You know what I mean? I don't think that's greedy at all. I think that's being extremely fair and giving anyone a chance to prove they deserve a title shot. Let's say Joe Smith Jr. thinks he can beat Shabransky, right? Why not fight him on the Canelo undercard? Boom! You're getting that Adonis title shot. WBC will mandate it. And even if you don't get that, you'll probably get the Kovalev Award winner. So, dude, you beat Shabransky, you're legit. Legit. Not the guy who was expected to lose, had lost, but caught Fonfara with a good punch. You're not that guy. You beat a legit. You would have actually beaten two if you beat Shabransky also, but he ain't just catching Shabransky on one punch, I'll tell you that. But he goes, whoever is feeding you info is wrong. At Shabransky is willing to fight Andre Ward for the exact same purse as Barrera. And then he goes, at Boxing Fanatic, at Steve UCN, at Steve Kim, at Shabransky only wants a fair purse. Andre Ward makes 1.8 mil for this fight. The Solaris goes, he says, Shabransky's team also said that they would have accepted $400,000 or even less. Barrera received $450,000 for the Ward fight. All right. Now, they had come to an agreement for much less than 450K, you know, much less, like 350, I think it was. They agreed for 350, and basically the offer got pulled off the table. The Ring magazine tried to reach out to Roc Nation and tried to reach out to HBO and tried to get, you know, their input and, you know, to see who's telling the truth here. Roc Nation wouldn't respond. HBO wouldn't respond. Alright. Shawnee Monahan really broke the story open wide. And then, you know, it was obviously bullshit that they were feeding us about Shabransky, too. But by the time all this came out, Ward and his people already told HBO, we've tried negotiating with these guys. No one will take the fight. I just saw an interview a few days ago with Virgil Hunter saying, we tried to fight every top, all the top light heavyweights, and none of them would take the fight. I'm not going to say any names, but they know who they are. Who the fuck did you try to fight? You know, please. Did you try to fight Shabransky for real? No. Did you try to fight Monahan for real? No. Did you try to fight Beater Beef? Beater BF? Did you send him an offer? No. Oh, wow. You know, what about Vodzdik? No. Like, come on. Alvarez, Elidier Alvarez, these are all the top light heavyweights. No. You know, Umar Salamov? No. You know, undefeated Russian badass. He got a little title, one of the, like, WBA regular ones or something. Anybody? Anybody? No. You know, they made two little lame offers and then were just like, eh. Pulled him off the table. And what they did to Monahan was really just lets you know. Shit. What they did to Monahan, and what Monahan said they did anyway, and they tried to get Roc Nation's response to what Shawnee Monahan said. They wouldn't comment, neither would HBO. And I'll get to that in a second here. And this is the Solaris. Shabransky would have been the closest template out there for them to prepare for Kovalev. That's why B-Hop drafted him in as a sparring partner when he fought Kovalev. And that's exactly right. There's nobody closer to Kovalev style. And everyone knows that. That's a fucking fact. You know, the best guy to get you ready to fight Kovalev is Shabransky. That's just a fact. There's not even a closer one in cruiserweight or 168 pound division. Like, he is the closest you can get anywhere near that weight range. And then he says, but Team Ward lowballed him and tried to sell it like he was being greedy. You know, check out what Shawnee Monahan had to say about them and Roc Nation lowballing him also after they offered him a fight against Ward. Quote, this is from Shawnee Monahan. The ups and downs of the outside the ring stuff can drain a guy even more than the physical toll taken from trading punches. With boxing being a Wild West frontier sport with no central league, making the schedule, the making of fights can be a wild, woolly, and confounding experience. That wasn't Shawnee Monahan. That was the journalist, the writer. And then he goes, Exhibit A. Shawnee Monahan, the Long Island-based light heavyweight, thought he'd gotten the opportunity of a lifetime 2 weeks ago when Andre Ward hadn't locked down his opponent for an August 6th clash in Oakland, and word went out that Shawnee could get the gig. Alright. Pull up this other one. He goes, here's the recollection of the 34-year-old Monahan on how he went from pumped to deflated over the span of the last couple days, roller coaster days. Now, let's be honest. I mean, Shawnee Monahan's a good fighter, undefeated, you know, tough dude. Is he the best to get you ready for Andre Ward? No. Is he better than Brand? Yeah, a lot better. Is he better than Shabransky? No, in my opinion, no, not at all. But, you know, it's a lot better than Brand, but not as good as Shabransky. So, let's see here what they did with the guy that's not as good as Shabransky. And everyone will agree on that. All right, he goes, this is a quote from Sonny Monahan. Basically, Rock Nation Sports promoter of Andre Ward asked Top Rank, would I be interested to fight Andre Ward in his hometown on short notice? I instantly said yes. All right, first of all, why does this fight have to be on short notice? Why did only people get offers on short notice? The guy knew he had this fight coming up forever. You know, he could have been making offers, you know, right after Barrera. Right after the Barrera fight, he could have had a deal set. You know, Kovalev did. He had Chalemba announced months before it happened. You know, but what, Ward couldn't do that? He had a date. HBO had a date for him. You know, even if you got to make it, you know, the date TBA, you can schedule a fight. You know, and tell the guy it'll be in this month somewhere. You get a close little grip from HBO, and then they tell you the official date. And then you, you know, announce the official date. You know, that would, they could handle that like that, man. HBO would do whatever for Ward, you know. He says, I instantly said yes. I found out the next day that they were offering half of what Sullivan Barrera got to fight Ward in his last fight, which I didn't feel was a great offer, being that I'm 27-0 and Barrera was 17-0. They said it was a final offer. Half of what Barrera got is $225,000. They were offering him $225,000. Ward's making $2 million. And if you need someone good to get, and everyone knows, you want the best guy possible to get you ready for Kovalev, right? If you had to pay up a little, and neither guy was asking for more money than Barrera. All right, now they were both willing to accept less than Barrera. But even if, let's just pretend that there was some other issues. Wouldn't you just kick up an extra $100,000, $200,000, $300,000, anything to get these guys in the ring? That way you actually get ready for Kovalev and you don't go in there against less than a sparring partner. I mean, let's face it, Andre Ward gets better sparring than Alexander Brand. Everyone knows that. Huh? Are you kidding? Of course he gets, you know, better sparring in the gym than he's going to see with Alexander fucking Brand. You know? So why didn't he fight Monahan or Shabransky? You know, clearly they thought the Shabransky fight, and in my opinion, they thought he was way too dangerous. Everyone knows that's a fight he could easily lose, and then the Kovalev fight would never even happen. But we'd get Shabransky versus Kovalev. I mean, that's a fight. You know, you got Kovalev and Shabransky, Kovalev and Beater Beef, Kovalev and Ward. You know, you got basically Kovalev, Shabransky, Ward, Beater Beef, Beater Beef. You know, Adonis, but eh. I mean, maybe Gvozdik, maybe, Umar Salamov. He hasn't really done much just yet. I don't know. One of them guys, you know, are probably the actual best, you know, the true top five. You know, they just need a couple fights and all them rankings will get fixed up. However, let's get back to what Monahan said. They said it was a final offer, so I accepted an offer for $225,000. Then Rock Nation asked what kind of gloves I wanted to wear. I said, I really don't care. I guess Everlast, because that's what I always wear. They said, no, you can't wear your Everlasts, which we know he wears a puncher's glove. They said, nope, no puncher's glove allowed. I mean, that's fucking bullshit, man. Bullshit. I can't stand a fucking fighter telling someone you can't wear a fucking glove. You gotta wear pillows if you're gonna fight me. I mean, it's fucking pathetic. I hate that shit. I hate that shit. I hear any fighter does that. That's just pisses me off. So, you can't wear your gloves. He goes, okay, that's fine. You know, they said no to that. He said, okay. Then they said, all your sponsors, all the sponsors that he wanted had to be okayed by Rock Nation. Why do they gotta be okayed by Rock Nation? If Shawnee wants to make money from a Long Island beer company, who cares? You know, why does it gotta be... That's the most ridiculous shit I've heard. But He said okay to that too. So whatever, okay. Which you can see, they keep throwing roadblocks at him. See, keep throwing shit at him to get him to say no. All right, they want him to say no. Purposely, that's why they're doing it. That's why they were like, super short money, short notice, hometown, you can't wear your gloves, you can't get the pay you want even from your sponsors. Because your biggest sponsor, they could just say no. And then he's going to be, you know, please. You know, they're really trying to just fuck the kid. We agreed on everything. You know, he said the deal breaker was, and this is what broke the deal. Rock Nation, another roadblock. The deal breaker was that if I had to pull out of the fight on short notice for any reason, Top Rank had to pay Rock Nation $700,000. But if Ward, who has pulled out of fights on short notice before, pulled out, Top Rank couldn't sue and had to pay for all their own expenses. It was basically unacceptable. The money sucked and they never negotiated anything. End quote. Now, what you can see right there, clearly they're throwing roadblock after roadblock, and Sean, he's just like, yep, give me the fight. And they're like, fuck! So the fighter was going to agree to anything. Shawnee Monahan was agreeing to anything. They figured that out, so they had to go after Bob Arum. $700,000, Bob, if your fighter gets injured, breaks his hand on a heavy bag in sparring, gets cut in sparring, any little thing that happens to him, and he in the fight, it's not that it's likely to happen, but it could. It happens a lot. All right? And Bob Arum would have to pay almost $1 million, $750,000, almost. $700,000 he'd have to pay. You know, Arum's like, are you fucking crazy? He's like, I'm sorry, Johnny, but I'm not risking $700,000 of my own dollars for you to get this fight. You know, that's just ridiculous. And then if Ward pulls out, I have to pay for all the expenses, and they stiff us with the bill. That'd be accepted by no promoter. You know a promoter, ask them if they would accept it. It's a guaranteed no. That was an instant deal breaker. That was not even the deal breaker. That was just the final fight ain't happening. You know, that's, you can't negotiate around that. $700,000, Arum would never take that chance. His fighter's training on short notice. The short notice fighters usually train extremely hard in those few weeks. So he's going to be having hard sparring, going hard on the bag in the midst, everything. He could bust his hand, a wrist, elbow, shoulder, knee, anything, cut, whatever. You know, anything could happen. I doubt it would have, since he hasn't pulled out of a fight ever, but an injury is going to happen eventually in his career. You know, and Arum's just like, dude, we'll get you a fight that I don't have to pay almost $1 million if you get injured, you know. So, you know, that was that. Rock Nation was extreme. And we've even heard Kathy Duva from Main Event say she's surprised Rock Nation can fucking put together a four-rounder. Just one four-rounder that is so hard to deal with. They're a bunch of pricks, you know, and they don't know the boxing business. And then they got all divas for Top Fighters. You got Cotto, who was a warrior before, but he's a diva now. Andre Ward, always been a diva. And Rigo, always been a diva. That's the three biggest fighters. All divas. I mean, so you got, anytime you deal with Rock Nation, the fight is going to be so hard to make with any of the three top fighters. You know, it's ridiculous. The writer says, strange circumstances. Seems like it has Monahan wondering which end is up and what was the point of the exercise. Alexander Brand was the rumored foe and was officially announced as the opponent soon after Monahan had his hopes dashed. And then this is a quote from Monahan. I believe Ward's people didn't want him in a... Well, this is... Oh, yeah, no, this is, yeah, quote from Monahan. I believe Ward's people didn't want him in a rough fight 3 months before fighting Sergey Kovalev. They had their guy in mind, Brand from Colombia. I think HBO didn't want him and told Ward to fight me. Or Shabransky, you can add that in there, too. But he's talking about himself, and he says, he thinks the outreach to make a Ward versus Monahan bout was not 100% and was more so done to create leverage to get brand okay. We reached out to Roc Nation to get their side and also offered the opportunity for HBO to weigh in. HBO didn't weigh in. Roc Nation just sent them the dude a fucking press release saying Iskowich resigned. That's it. And nothing to do with the questions he wanted answered. And he actually said he gave them he tried to get them on the phone, just somebody, nobody. He gave them like a printout of just questions he wanted answered, and they could have sent him an email back. Nothing. That's what they sent him. A press release saying Iskowich retired. HBO wouldn't talk. Roc Nation wouldn't talk. So who are you going to believe? You know what I mean? I'm sorry, when one guy says something and it clearly makes sense, because it seems like it just the same thing happened with another fighter. But the side in question refuses to comment on it? Come on, man. Please. And, Virgil and Ward, you can ask them. They're going to fucking lie. We all know it. They're going to lie. They lie all the time. You know, it's ridiculous. It's just flat out ridiculous. So, that is Monahan's, case on it and saying exactly what he thinks it was. Then you add in the whole Shabransky deal. That's clearly what it was. I mean, you could decide and tell me what you think. But I'm telling you, that's my opinion. I mean, I'm not saying you have to agree. I'm not saying it's a fact. But to me, it clearly looks like that was the case. But let's go down the list of these light heavyweights real quick for Slava Shabransky. Who is, again, WBC number 5. He wants a shot at the WBC title. He'll fight Kovalev. He'll fight anybody. Beat the hell out of Unieski Gonzalez. The judges had it a majority decision because one of them had it a draw, which is flat out ridiculous. Flat out ridiculous. I don't see how you get a draw. I mean, Shabransky was, washed him for a stretch, like 9 rounds, 8 rounds or something like that. And then they had a few good rounds. But it was a good fight. It was extremely entertaining because, they both come to fight. We know Gonzalez comes to fight. We know Shabransky comes to fight. But, Shabransky's just on another level, man. Sucks for Gonzalez. I liked him. But, at the same time, I like Shabransky. And, the best man win. Hopefully Gonzalez gets another shot. Him and the Pascal deal was a little rough, but, he got another big fight versus Shabransky. Shabransky, of course, made the most of it and clearly won. But he got all that buzz. Everyone was talking about him, and I'm like, Golden Boy, what are you doing? You got all this buzz with this fighter. Dude, put him in a fucking big fight, another one. Everyone's talking about this guy in this fight. Everyone was talking about Gonzalez, and then Shabransky beats Gonzalez, so it's like, boom, boom, the buzz is, the train's rolling, you're picking up steam, and then they just, slowed everything down, had the Derek Finley fight, blasted him out. He got a fight coming up in August against Rojas, who, he's on blast out of there in a round or two. Again, Shabransky's on a totally another level than Rojas. I think that's how you say his name. I think it's Rojas, yeah. But Sergey Kovalev, all right. Can he fight? Kovalev's busy right now, right? Ward. Let's go Adonis, since he's WBC number 5. Adonis could snatch him up. But we know Adonis don't fight top light heavyweights. That's why the Ring Magazine took their belt off of him, because he don't fight top light heavyweights. In my opinion, Andre Ward, Adonis Stevenson is a total, like, just disgrace to the light heavyweight championship, man. You can't just get a belt, fight two times a year against scrubs, and that's it. You know, that's it. I mean, how long's he had that? How many title defenses has he had? Something like six or something? Versus nobody. You know, Green Fonfara's the best one. You know, I mean, come on, man. But Adonis, you know, wanted to fight back in the day. I heard Yvonne Michelle bitching up a storm about, you know, Al Heyman won't let Adonis, you know, get in there with anyone he wants. It's basically just whoever Al puts in front of him. So maybe the blame is on Al. But, you know, with what happened with Adonis and Kovalev, that kind of lets you know Adonis is a coward. When he put up the whole, we got to do the Showtime HBO co-main pay-per-view type. Like, they're never going to work together for a Kovalev fucking Adonis pay-per-view. It got to be big money. That's not the kind of money. Right, that's a boom. And he, dude, don't even have a fucking deal with Showtime. Like, why is he talking about Showtime when he didn't even have a deal with them? He still don't. You know, it's ridiculous. But, you know, so Kovalev busy. Adonis, please. Andre Ward. Andre Ward's just looking for that payday versus Kovalev. He ain't trying to take any risks, you know, before that Kovalev fight. Maybe, if he beats Kovalev, maybe he'll step it up. You know, maybe he'll be, okay, I'm ready to go and fight guys like Shabransky and Beter Biev and, you know, Umar Salamov and give Kovalev a rematch, fight Adonis Stevenson. You know, maybe he'll do all that and actually do what Kovalev is doing. You know, got the belts and trying to fight everyone and clean out the division. But then, you know, people were saying, you know, HBO, they'd rather have Kovalev win because he's so easy to work with, you know, that he'll fight anybody, anywhere, anytime. Same goes for Shabransky, by the way. His exact words, I'll fight anyone, anywhere, anytime. You know, I mean, you should hear how much this guy just wants to fight, you know. And he's telling people, I'll take extremely low money to get into the ring on a huge card versus anybody. You know, imagine Adonis Stevenson on a Canelo undercard versus Shabransky, and all he got to do is pay Shabransky $150,000. You know, it'll never happen. We know that, but, you know, and because of the whole PBC Golden Boy and, you know, Al Heyman, whatever. You know, Oscar, whatever, you know. But then you got, so Andre Ward, just flat out, he ain't taking no risks until that Kovalev fight. He's not going to risk, I mean, he fights Shabransky, he probably loses. I'll be fucking honest. He probably loses. I'd favor Shabransky. In their next fight, after what I just saw, him versus Barrera, yeah, I think Shabransky beats him. I think he beats him clearly. Shabransky probably get robbed if he didn't knock him out, in my opinion, you know, but at least we would know who really won, you know, but that would be, we all know that would be argued from all the Ward fans. Shabransky didn't really win. Ward put on a masterclass. I mean, he could get dropped three times. He still might get robbed, you know, because that fucking Kovalev fight. So Ward ain't taking no risks before that fight. That's why he's fought the guys that he has fought, okay? And he's getting $2 million for each one. You know, fight three bums, $6 million. That probably add up to a little more. And then you get the Kovalev pay-per-view, right? If you beat him, now you're the man, right? And he can start making all these fucking demands that he likes, which is bullshit, because Kovalev's the man. And don't put any demands on nobody. He was willing to fight Beter Biev in Russia, Moscow, which is, that's Beter Biev's home turf. Two-time Russian Olympian, that's his home country. I mean, you know, Kovalev says the only reason he lost to Beter Biev in the Olymp, or in the, you know, the amateurs, is because it was in Russia and the Russians screwed him. But, you know, it is what it is. Kovalev will fight anyone, anytime, you know. Hopkins, right outside of Philly and AC. Canada with Pascal. The UK with Cleverly. You know, Russia with Beter Biev. Beter Biev turned the offer down. A career high payday, chance at three world titles in his backyard. turned the offer down. And that was going to be Kovalev's fucking fight instead of Chalemba. I mean, so you can't say Chalemba was a cherry pick or anything like that. Kovalev went after the best fighters possible. He would much rather have fought fucking Andre Ward instead of Chalemba, but Andre wasn't ready. You know, he needs another tune-up. You know, what the fuck is it? Alexander Brand ain't even sparring, man. It's not even sparring. So Ward, no, not happening, man. He wants no parts of Szymanski. No parts of Szymanski, in my opinion. Or no parts of anyone who's a threat. But Szymanski wants everybody and will fight anybody. All right, and that's, I just love hearing that. You know, that's what you want to hear from a fighter. You know, and we hear that a lot from the Eastern Europeans. You know, the Ukrainians, the Russians, you know, the Kazakhstanis, the you know, Hungarians, they're the whole Eastern Bloc, man. They just want to fight, prove they're the best. It's not about these diva demands and getting some money. They figure, I'll get to the top, and the money comes with it. You know, like I said, I remember Nigel Benn saying, if you're in this game for just money, you should not be fighting. You know, he said, you should be in the game to win world titles and be the best in your division, and the money comes with it. You know, the money shouldn't be your first worry. You know, first worry should be proving you're the best. You know, then, you know, you gotta make sure the money's right. I understand that. Don't you want yourself to get robbed? But you don't put extreme demands on people to where you know fights can't get made. You know, screw fights up. That's not what you do. You know, because imagine if Ward had beaten Szymanski, then beat Kovalev. You know, that would prove he's pound for pound number one. You know, but he's not. He's not. He's nowhere fucking near pound for pound number one. People can blow smoke up your ass all they want. If you want to believe it, you can believe it. In my opinion, again, this is my opinion. No way. No way in hell. Not even top five. Not even top five. But Elidier Alvarez, right? He got that suspect W over Chalemba. He won't fight Szymanski. He's waiting for Adonis. Alright. And Joe Smith Jr., also, he's WBC number two. He got the little international WBC title, so he will get a shot at, you know, Adonis eventually. And apparently, you know, they want, Szymanski wanted Joe Smith Jr. Szymanski wants Joe Smith Jr. Szymanski's team wants Joe Smith Jr. They want to fight, you know, get themselves up them WBC rankings, right? So they're figuring go after Joe Smith Jr., get that international belt, and now we'll hopefully get a fight with Adonis, right? Will that ever be mandated? You know, who knows? But we'd have to wait and find out. But that's what they want to do, right? They're trying to prove they're the best, and that's, you can't do anything but respect that. I don't care if Ward's your favorite fighter. It's like, oh well, you know, your guy ain't trying to fucking, you know, fight the best, you know, every fight out. And he's trying to fight three total tomato cans and then one fight. Like, wow. So in other words, Pacquiao can go fight three number 50th fucking box rec guys, then fight Crawford, and you'll all be happy, right? You won't bitch about none of his tune-ups, right? Yeah, okay. Okay. Oh, yeah, it makes a lot of sense, huh? My ass. Joe Smith Jr. is specifically waiting on Adonis Stevenson, hoping to get picked eventually. So he's just going to fucking sit on the bench and wait. You know, whatever. That's not what I like to hear from a fighter. Alexander Vozdik, Szymanski tried to fight him. He turned an offer down. You know, I think he turned a couple offers down. I can't be exact, but they tried to fight Vozdik. So that's a fight they would love to get that fight. Imagine that fight, Szymanski and Vozdik on the undercard of Canelo Liam Smith. You know, because they need to stack that undercard. Otherwise, it ain't selling what they're hoping, man. Not at all. So they need to stack that undercard. That would be a great fight. Two Ukrainian, I think. Is Vozdik from Ukraine or Russia? He's Ukrainian, right? Yeah. I believe so. Yeah, I think so anyway. But that'd be a great fight. Great, great fight. And that actually, in my opinion, would prove who's basically the number two light heavyweight in the world. And the winner out of them, honestly. Because Adonis ain't fighting nobody. Ward ain't fighting nobody. You know, if he, after the Kovalev fight, then we can truly rank him. But, you know, until then, you got to rank the guys who are fighting the best. You know? And specifically, we know trying to. Shabransky tried to get Pascal. HBO wouldn't agree to it because he's coming off two back-to-back losses. And they didn't like that as a fight. I don't think Pascal would have liked that as a fight. I think Shabransky would have fucking ended his career. But that would have been a big fight, you know? What, just because Pascal lost to Kovalev means you don't have a chance against Shabransky? You know? You know, you just saw him against Gonzalez. You know, and it's not even two back-to-back losses. It's a loss, win-loss, but we just saw him against Gonzalez. You know, did he necessarily win? That's debatable. But he put on a good performance, right? Shabransky schooled Gonzalez, but what's wrong with that fight? You know, put it up in Canada. It's a big money fight. You know? I mean, I don't know. You know, it. What? So Pascal's never going to get a big fight again? Or something? I mean, it just don't make sense. You know, Pascal should be wanting to fight a guy like Shabransky to prove he isn't done and that he can beat a guy like Kovalev. He can't beat Kovalev. Maybe Shabransky, I personally don't think he has a chance in hell. But, yeah, they tried to fight Pascal. Just saying. Top light heavyweight, ring ranked, whatever. Is he even still ranked in ring? I don't know. Beat or BF. Awesome fight. Great, great fight. Unfortunately, Beat or BF is with Al Haymon a little bit, you know. I don't know about that fight. Hopefully, we get to see that soon. That'd be a great fight. I think they... I don't know. I could see that fight, both of them cleaning out the division a little bit, along with Kovalev, Ward, and, you know, Vozdik, whoever, Salamov, all them guys, all clear it out a little bit, then all fight each other. But, dude, there's so many top guys in the light heavyweight division. They need to just start mixing and matching these guys. We get so many good fights. You know, that's what people, they're not understanding anymore. People are watching boxing to, like, just, like, bandwagon shit. Just, to like, they don't care how boring a fighter is, who he fights. They're just, wee, yeah. But then there's fighters out there willing to fight anybody, will fight anybody. They don't get the support. And then if they did get the support, we could actually get a ton of great fights, like in the 80s and before, you know, even the 90s, when guys would just be like, he's the best in my division, get him in the ring with me. He thinks he can beat me, get me in the ring with him. I don't care, his backyard, whatever, get me in the ring with him. We have guys like that, you know. Roy used to do the same shit, Roy Jones Jr. I'm talking about, but, you know, I mean, everyone used to back then, you know. Hagler, get him in the ring with me right now. He said he can beat me, get me in that ring. Same thing. You know, we have guys like that today. They just don't get the support. That's the sad thing about boxing, you know. Guys would rather support divas, cowards. And yes, fighters can be cowards because they don't want to fight dangerous fights. That don't mean they won't fight a guy that they have an 80% chance of winning or beating, but they won't fight the guy who has an 80% chance of beating them, you know, to prove that they're the best. Like, no, I can overcome that shit. Trust me. You know, get him in a ring. No, you know, there's, you know, those guys actually get support from people. I can't believe it, but, you know, I've seen it, and we all know they do. But I support the real dudes, ones that want to just fight everybody and prove they are the best. You know, it has nothing to do with any other bullshit bias that some people have, and that's why they fucking bandwagon certain fighters. No, I have a specific criteria. You know, it's very clear cut. You know, act like a real contender, act like a real champion. We all know what that means. You know, everyone knows what that means if you have half a boxing brain. I'm not even getting into it. But hopefully we get that Vitor BF fight. Fonfara, specifically waiting for Adonis also, even though he got chinned by Joe Smith Jr. I mean, wouldn't Fonfara love to come back and fight Shabransky? And if he can beat Shabransky, boom, he's back. He's the talk of the town. But he ain't beating him, I'll tell you that. But either way, you know, still a good-ass fight. That's two top light heavyweights going at it. And the winner, boom, gets moved up. Nathan Cleverly, I don't even know how I wrote that name down here, I don't know. Chalemba. Maybe, you know, in the future, but as of now, I don't think they ever tried to fight Chalemba. I'm not sure. I know they have dealt with main events for Barrera, but Chalemba, I don't know. You know, Chalemba would actually be a good fight. For them, you know, Chalemba's just a hell of a fighter, man. That'd be a really good fight, too. If Shabransky can beat Chalemba, that'd be really impressive. Imagine if he beats him more impressively than Kovalev, you know. So that is a fight, actually. He should try to get. And again, undercard of Canelo, 150K, Chalemba Shabransky. That'd be a great fight. Marcus Brown. I used to be very big on Marcus Brown, you all know that. Then he had his last fight where he got destroyed. And fought like a little girl, clinching all the time, running the whole fight, and then they totally robbed the dude who beat him. I can't remember the guy's name. The guy scolded the shit out of him. Was a great fighter. Not a great fighter, but very good fighter. He might be great, I don't know. I thought Marcus Brown was the goods. You know, all my videos I was saying, Marcus Brown. If this guy got a chin, he is going to be a terror in the light heavyweight division. Then he got that step-up fight, just got destroyed. He only won like two rounds. And then they totally robbed the guy. And then Marcus had the nerve to say he thought the other guy only won two rounds and that he clearly won the fight. You know, I might have still supported him because he ain't the judge. You know, I mean, he's just a fighter, even though he fought like a bitch and that was really sickening. But that, you know, added up with the fact that he was being so arrogant afterwards and not saying this guy needs a rematch. We need to run this one back. I can admit a defeat. No, not even let's rematch, nothing, just no, I ain't fighting him again, I won. get out of here, you know, Marcus Brown don't want no parts of Shabransky. Shabransky would knock his head off, please, it'd be like, just like Kovalev fighting Marcus Brown, he's done. Umar Salamov, again, that's a good fight. Some of you might not be up on Salamov yet, but you need to be. I think he got the WBA regular title. I'm not sure exactly which title he has. I think he has a WBA title, though. He's a beast. I mean, you'll be seeing him fighting someone soon, because he's going to have that step-up fight really soon. He's a beast. Salamov and Shabransky, great fight. I don't know anything about that, though. I don't know. I don't talk to Salamov's people at all. Shawnee Monahan, you know, be an alright fight, you know. Since Ward wouldn't fight Shabransky or Monahan, Shabransky and Monahan could just get it on, you know. They could put that on the undercard of Canelo. Come up with, shit, I'm sure, 250 grand you can get both guys in the ring, you know. Shit. Mohammadi, even though he just got, I think he just got beat, yeah, bad, actually, beat badly twice, but he's a top 25 light heavyweight, you know, was a former Ring Magazine top 10 light heavyweight. He's with main events. Maybe, you know, main events would be willing to just throw him in the ring with Shabransky. since Kovalev already beat him and he already got knocked the hell out by Gassiev. I think that's who crushed him. Who the hell blasted him out? I can't remember. I'm getting different fights mixed up. But, you know, Muhammadi, maybe. Be a good name on his resume. You know, prove that he, you know, he can blast them out just like everyone else. Then you got Chudinov. Not necessarily the top light heavyweight, but again, a top 25 light heavyweight. Be a good fight, a good experience fight for Shabransky. I'd like to see that one. I don't know anything about that. Sullivan Barrera, they have tried to fight him a few times. Kept getting screwed up. We could have seen, if Ward didn't fight Barrera, we would have saw Shabransky and Barrera. Shabransky had beat the shit out of Barrera, though. And, you know, main event's got plans for Barrera, so they're not giving him up just yet. Not to Shabransky anyway. We'll have to see what they do with him. But Shabransky wants him. You know, he'll be willing to fight him on the undercard, 150K. And that'd be a good fight for him, too. Like, I even told his manager, I was like, go after Barrera, try to beat him more impressively than Ward. Which ain't that hard, and he would do. I think he would knock him out. That's a way to get that buzz going again. And, you know, that's the thing. That buzz was really rolling for Shabransky, and people are still talking about him. And, no, he's a top-light heavyweight and a terror, but he got to get a big fight. You know, we need to see this guy in a big fight, people. You know, that's the thing. I mean, I don't get it, you know. That's a lot of names. You know, he's willing to fight any of them, anytime, anywhere. You know, pay-per-view, the Canelo undercard or not on undercard. You know, but he's even saying, like, they're literally saying the offer. Anyone wants to fight us, call Golden Boy, because he's under Shabransky is under Golden Boy. Call Golden Boy, get on the Canelo undercard with us, 150K. So it's called, man, Golden Boy, be like, yo, we want Shabransky, we want to be on that undercard, we'll pay him 150K. What's so hard about that? You know? Crazy, right? And Shabransky would have a very short time to even train for that specific opponent, while the other guy could train specifically for Shabransky for fucking 8 weeks. You know? But, you know, I'm just saying that,